into the SEC Game of the Week. It is presented by Regions Bank. And this afternoon it comes to you from one of the great basketball palaces in America. 23,000 plus at Rupp Arena in downtown Lexington. And two men that are as close as any two in athletics. Tony Barbee, the head coach of the Auburn Tigers, against his mentor, John Calipari, the head coach of the Kentucky Wildcats. These two teams begin the second half of this 18-game SEC schedule today. And looky there, all those folks who were talking about the demise of Kentucky, they've now got a half-game lead in second place, just a game behind Florida. Hi, everybody. Dave Baker alongside my lead guard, the 2008 Olympic gold medalist, Kara Lawson. Kara, this is a Kentucky team that, yeah, they had to find themselves early on, but they're playing some of their best basketball and some of the best in the league right now.
Absolutely. They've won 6 of 7. This is a team that, as you mentioned, Dave, has gone through some growing pains, but they're getting better at the right time. They've added Willie Cauley-Stein back into the rotation. This is a team in Kentucky on the uptick.
Cauley-Stein was not in the lineup when Kentucky beat Auburn handily down in Auburn, but one guy was, and one is the number for our Shelter Insurance one-on-one. And it's not one-on-one, it's just one. Nerlens Noel, who's having as big an impact for this team as any in the country.
Absolutely. There's been a lot of talk over the last couple of weeks about National Defensive Player of the Year. And you can take out Aaron Kraft, Victor Oladipo, Jeff Withey. Give me Nerlens Noel. This is a young man that's in the top 25 in steals. He's the nation's leader in block shots. He impacts the game in so many ways, and he's been the leader for this young Kentucky team.
He's the hardest worker on this Kentucky team, Kara, and while he's the most talented, no surprise that when we left shoot around today, he was still in the gym.
No surprise. Just because a lot of people look at a player like Nerlens Noel and think everything comes easy to him. He works at his craft. He wants to improve his free throw shooting. Obviously, that's been a struggle for him at the different times this season, but I mean, what a commodity to have a young man that gets it in every facet of the game and really impacts the game on the defensive end.
Auburn broke a 6-game losing streak with a big win over Alabama the other night. They tinkered with the lineup. That'll be part of our story today. And Kentucky in the home white with the opening possession. Tigers starting a man-to-man.
We'll see a mix of man and zone from Auburn. They did that in the last meeting against Kentucky.
And that is not a good sign for the Wildcats, as Archie Goodwin has struggled mightily with his shot as of late. And I had a chance to see practice yesterday and the shoot around today, and those struggles continue. Speaking of struggling, Frankie Sullivan, who went 1 of 13 against the Crimson Tide, misses his first.
You know, so much of offensive basketball is your head, is your mentality, your confidence. And if your head's in the right place and you're a confident player and you get open looks, you're going to knock them down. And so when you're a young player and sometimes you have a bad game, you're Frankie Sullivan, maybe you go 1 for 13. It's about getting your head back right and knocking down those open shots.
There's Noel with the offensive rebound. And the Cats back it back out. Strip inside, and they say that Payne is guilty of the foul against Noel.
This is an area of the game that Nerlens Noel has gradually improved through the course of the season. His composure when he catches on the block. There's so many things going on. Are you getting a double team? Are they faking at you? Where is that double team coming from? Where's the open player? All that a post player has to process when he catches the basketball on the block.
Nobody's been able to connect yet. Julius Mays has missed a couple. Goodness gracious. And a foul at the other end. Nothing but Jordan Granger to do, but hit the contact, and he'll send Goodwin to the line. There you see the starting lineup for the Auburn Tigers. Josh Wallace, the senior, the former walk-on in there. Jordan Granger, the freshman, got his first start last time out against Alabama.
When you take a look, if you're Auburn, it's going to be about opportunities. And you can't miss that many opportunities, clean looks at the basket, as you take a look at the youth of the Kentucky lineup. And you know, no surprise they've gone with this lineup for the last few games. Of course, Cauley-Stein and Wiltshire give them great production off the bench.
Goodwin called for the travel. First turnover of the afternoon against Kentucky. And there you see Willie Cauley-Stein, big man from Olathe, Kansas, had a knee problem, required some minor surgery. First game that he missed was the game at Auburn, but he is back now, giving the Cats additional depth, but really helping their level of preparation in practice.
Also their energy. I mean, Willie Cauley-Stein's a player that when, if he laces it up for practice, the practice is different. The energy of practice, how hard you have to work, how hard Nerlens Noel has to practice on a daily basis. If Cauley-Stein is in the lineup, it really changes this Kentucky team.
Payne hits it one end, and that's what Kentucky will do as Ryan Harrow answers immediately.
That's a great sign for Kentucky. Ryan Harrow and his aggressive nature on the offensive end. He needs to improve that, needs to have that for 40 minutes.
Both teams putting it up from the outside, and that's Noel Johnson, a guy that can hit the triple, but he's had a crisis of confidence lately with his shot. Things beginning to heat up after a slow start at Rupp Arena, and the Cats come with full court pressure. Bucket goes in for Alan Payne. And that's what Tony Barbee talked to us about before the game, Kara, is the fact if you got a fast break layup, he wants that.
Oh, he called them press break layups, and he said we want to try to get as many as we can if Kentucky extends. The thing he does not want is press break threes. He feels like that just puts you in a bad position with the press and the trap coming at you.
Harrow couldn't get it to go. Nice feed. Sullivan got it to Chubb.
Basket by Chubb.
First touch of the afternoon for Alex Poitras. Goodwin draws the contact. Chubb draws his first. It's the third against the Tigers. Kentucky has not been whistled for a foul yet. As you see, John Calipari, who at the start of this SEC season decided to discard the tie. Gone with the business casual look here from that point out. Substitutions, first of the game for the Cats. Harrow and Poitras go out. Jared Polson, a walk-on from nearby Nicholasville, Kentucky, checks in, as does Kyle Wilcher, big man known for his outside shot, who's become a pretty good post threat lately. Oh, my goodness, are you kidding?
Wow.
Where did that come from? Mays lobs it up, and Noel bails him out. The Cats trail early. Today's SEC basketball game is brought to you by Regions Bank, proud sponsor of the SEC. Buffalo Wild Wings, wings, beer, sports. And by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Got a good one early on here at Rupp Arena as we begin the second half of the SEC schedule. Yes. Visiting Auburn Tigers with a 10-8 lead over Kentucky. But Carol Lawson, what about this last hookup between Mays and Noel?
Well, great presence of mind there by Julius Mays to look to go over the top. I mean, anytime you're talking about Nerlens Noel going over the top, is a great job. That's his left hand. I mean, that's amazing that he was able to get this reach and just guide it into the basket. He wasn't able to get control of it with his hand, so he just guided it in.
It's like one of those volleyball deals at the net where you're just trying to push it over, and you saw him with the right hand signal for Mays to put it up there. He felt he had the advantage, and he used it. 6'10 freshman from Everett, Massachusetts. And he told me earlier today that he shoots at least 100 additional free throws. He's got that average up to 51%, but he is a much better shooter at the line than he was at the beginning of the year. And a An offensive rebound pulled down by Asan Dixon Tatum, but they say he pushed off to get the position. Fourth foul against the Tigers. Dixon Tatum's first.
We'll see that action a lot from Auburn. They feel like they have an advantage there with Wilcher at the four and Noel Johnson looking to attack with him on the pick and pop and even on the drive.
Noel tried to get it into Polson on the cut. Second turnover by the Cats. Sullivan looking to create. Nice pass inside, but that's what Noel can do. And Mark Whitehead, the outside official, says that he got him down low.
Let's take a look at this again. I mean, that looks like not a foul to me. And it looked like also the whistle was blown a little bit premature, even before Noel got the block. Maybe a little bit with his left hand touching his body, but that looked like clean block to me. I don't see it.
And then he blocked it about his elbow. I mean, but it is what it is, as they say. And Noel goes to the bench after his first foul. And Willie Cauley-Stein, number 15 there at the bottom of your screen, who did not play in the earlier game at Auburn, back in there. I'll tell you one thing that happens with Nerlens Noel, too. He gets his back up a little bit about a call like that, and boy, he really ratchets it up. Shaq Johnson, number 5, in there for Auburn for the first time.
And you can see it at times. There's still moments with Cauley-Stein, with Noel, where the game is a little fast for them, and there's double teams coming. They're not sure, and they're a little bit undecided and tentative. And that continues to be an area of growth for them, being on the block, back to the basket, making good decisions.
With one on the shot clock, and Mays can't get it to go. Battle on the floor, and the arrow points the way of the Auburn Tigers.
That's cool. You're scrappier guys, Cauley-Stein and Polson. And Polson's really benefited from the absence of Cauley-Stein, getting some increased minutes. And, you know, his value to this team is the fact that he can really put ball pressure on in the full court, turn the point guard, and really help try and wear that player down.
Auburn 4 of 9 from the field. Kentucky 3 out of 8. In what has been a year of less than stellar shooting overall in college basketball.
How about just bad shooting? I'll go with that. I mean, I know you're trying to be nice, Dave, but
thank you.
It's been some bad shooting in college basketball this season.
What do you think the reason's been?
You know, look at Polson.
How about that hustle? Crowd on their feet, liking the effort. And it leads to a roller by Archie Goodwin. And the officials whistled that there was basket interference. It went in anyway.
We already see how much the game has changed when Polson and Cauley-Stein have come in. So many times when you get a great defensive play, guys hitting the floor first, whatever team, whatever player hits the floor first, that's going to lead to something good, and that certainly leads to that Goodwin basket. There was some Auburn player pulled down the net, but it looked like the basket was going to go anyways.
Polson is shoved. And there you take a look at Willie Cauley-Stein on the Kentucky bench. I can't tell whether he got hit in the head or the nose, you know, scrambling for that ball. He's holding that nose, and here he is right here. Oh, gosh, he got hit in the side of the head. And then he took a shot to the nose off somebody's knee. And I think he's just trying to shake it off over there right now. Johnson picks up his first foul. Tough catch by Wilcher, and it's Shaq Johnson who commits the foul. And that'll put Auburn over the limit and put Kentucky at the free throw line. Coming up next Saturday on the SEC Network at 1:30, Florida visits Auburn. And at 4, South Carolina takes on Alabama. Check your local listings for the game in the station in your area.
Obviously not what you want if you're Tony Barbie. You put Kentucky in a bonus. There's 13 minutes left in the game, and it's been a physical affair thus far, but just that far away from the basket. I know it's hustle, and I know you're fighting for trying to get that loose ball if you're Shaq Johnson, but just needless foul there to give Kentucky 2 points.
I think, Kara, it's probably part of the template, though, that people are using against Kentucky. John Calipari talked about how his point guards have got to be more physical, and I think people are trying to get more physical with the Cats.
There's no question. You watch Kentucky on tape, and you watch some of their personnel, whether it's Harrow or Noel, Cauley Stein. The first thing you think of is, I can push these guys off their spots. I can move them. I can make life difficult for them if I'm physical. And if I'm physical long enough, they'll stop being physical back, especially Harrow.
And as somebody who still plays, like you do in the WNBA, as the shot goes down for Chris Denson, you can sense that as an opponent, right?
You see it. You can see it, certainly. And as you see Shaq Johnson going down here.
Boy, just after that shot went in by Denson, I turned my head for a second, and all of a sudden I turned and saw Johnson just holding his left ankle. And I'm not sure whether he got hit, whether he stepped on somebody's foot going back on defense. The freshman from Atlanta, obviously, in a lot of pain. Take a look at the top of the screen. I'm not sure whether he got caught up with
Didn't look
Denson.
Like there was anybody around. Looked like he just tried to change direction in the open floor. And something buckled.
Right at the top of your screen. Check it out.
There's no one around there, Dave.
No. Sometimes that just happens. But he rolled it pretty good. And that brings in Ahsan Dixon Tatum into the Auburn lineup. And we'll update you on the condition of Shaq Johnson as soon as we know it. Harrow back in there for Kentucky. Olsen off the kick out.
He's been a difference maker so far this afternoon on both ends of the floor. Jared Polson has infused some life and some energy into this Wildcat team, the crowd as well.
Young man out of West Jessamine High School that is a real crowd favorite. John Calipari, you know, you think about saying this from a team that's the defending national champion. He likes him in there for his toughness. And Poitras getting a hand in there and creating the held ball. The arrow points to the Wildcats. And the coach points to the walk-on, whose jumper puts the Cats back on top.
You know I love you, right? I want to give you this. Yeah, it's bacon. It's bacon, baby. Will you share it with me?
Yes.
Yes. She said yes.
Who can say no to bacon?
He went to Crystal.
And no one does bacon like the Bacon Cheese Crystal. Smothered in cheese, piled with bacon. Get two plus fries and a drink for just $3.99. Only at Crystal.
What's the only thing better than saving money at Kroger? Saving 50%. What a deal. Stop by Kroger now and save 50% on things like Classico pasta sauce, Pepperidge Farm bag cookies, Bird's Eye Voila skillet meals. Save 50% on quilted northern bath tissue, Nabisco premium saltines, and more. Look for the 50% off yellow sale tags and save big. Go to Kroger.com for more items. Get more value for the way you live every day at Kroger.
Kentucky with a 16-14 lead, approaching the midway point of this first half, and Auburn has stayed in this one, Kara Lawson, thanks to great execution.
We're going to call it Occupy the Post. Did you see Frankie Sullivan? He comes out, sees Norlens Noel flat. He knows he's going to have the roller and Chubb, and so he hesitates and occupies Norlens Noel. That gives Chubb just enough space there to get the layup in. That's a great job by Sullivan. If you come off that ball screen and you see it's a flat hedge, you don't have your shot. You can occupy that post long enough, you're going to get your big man on that hard roll. That's a great job by Auburn. And their execution on the offensive end is a big reason why this is a two-point game.
Auburn has come out and hit 5 out of 13 from the field. They're 2 of 4 from the line. In the last 4-0-1, though, Auburn has only hit 1 of its last 5. Goodwin has not been able to get untracked in this one. Poythress is trying to post up inside. Boy, if he can do that, that's a big step forward for this Kentucky team down the stretch.
Yeah, it is. They love that action. Sometimes they'll do it to start the game. ATO's out of timeouts. They love to take advantage and exploit the strength and power of Poythress.
Colson with the back tap created a steal. Second turnover by the Tigers. Payne forced into a bad shot. And even though they couldn't convert last time, the pace very much to the liking of the Wildcats.
Yeah, very much so. They want to get up and down, get Goodwin, Poythress, some of their wing players in transition opportunities.
Poythress again. And Tony Barbee wants to take a timeout. All season long, Alex Poythress has been the X factor for this Kentucky team. No question about his ability, but can he get the motor up to the recommended RPMs?
Well, that's the key. Poythress should be able to do this on almost every other play down the court. The strength, the speed, ability, the first step, he should be able to wear out that baseline because of his ability to finish. And with Goodwin and Poythress, it's just a matter of them being consistent, not disappearing, giving great effort.
Let's take a look at our Toyota SEC leaders. Points per game. I saw Marshall Henderson put up 26 of his 31 in the second half the other night. Kentavious Caldwell-Pope has led a resurgence for the Georgia team, Kara.
Georgia, a little bit of a surprise at 5-4 in the league. And Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, you know, the only player on their team in double figures. And he's carried a lot of the load for Mark Fox and that team on the offensive end.
And you saw Frankie Sullivan still fourth in the league in terms of scoring, but his troubles continue. I mean, he was 1 of 13 the other night. He's 0 for 2 today. And Auburn, as Wallace drew that foul, Cauley Stein committed it, and they'll put him on the hit. Top of that press. We'll talk about that some more. Where do the points come from for the Tigers, who are badly in need of a basket with Kentucky on a 7-0 run? Can't believe it. Thought his guy was held. And you know, you don't want to be overly dramatic, but how about the freshman going there to get his teammates back?
Well, at the end, I can see what he was talking about, but on the tie-up, clearly the hands were on the ball. But Dixon Tatum, I mean, he's been aggressive. He's a physical guy down there in the paint, and that's what Chubb and Dixon Tatum, that tandem, they're going to try to be as physical as they can with the Kentucky front line.
Boy, nice execution by the Tigers off the inbounds. Noel Johnson got wide open and knocked down the triple. Chubb in transition. And they say he draws the foul.
We've seen from both teams the missed opportunities around the basket, and certainly Cauley-Stein can't handle the pass. Fortuitous bounce there, or Cauley-Stein hits Noel and just not able to finish. How about Chubb, though, getting out, running the floor, realizing that both Noel and Cauley-Stein were backed up, and he was able to get a freebie.
Noel is in a situation where he's not only trying to jam it, I mean, he's trying to do some damage when he jams it.
You got to go up strong. I mean, you got to go up strong. You have to finish with authority. That's the type of aggressiveness that John Calipari's trying to instill into these players. Noel, Poitras, Goodwin, be aggressive, attack, handle the physical part of the game.
Auburn now looks like they've gone zone for the first time. Poitras. A nice rebound underneath as Johnson was there with the box out. John Calipari now saw his team go on a 7-0 run. And look at what Auburn has done to answer. They have erased Kentucky's biggest lead of the afternoon and gone back on top by a point.
Noel Johnson has come off of the bench and has hit three huge threes. And it's what Tony Barbie talked about his team needed. Remember, in their last game against Kentucky where they lost, they were 0 for 15 from beyond the arc. 0 for 15. Did not hit a three. Got some quality looks at the basket. Well, you know what's happening this afternoon? They're making some of those shots from beyond the arc, and that's a big reason why they're leading this game by one.
Some of those shots. 4-6 from outside the arc. There you see that number. And only 3 of 12. And Tony Barbie told us before the game, he thought what, 7-8 was the number?
7-8 was the number for them to be in the game. He didn't say win the game, but for them to be in the game down the stretch.
Of made threes.
They're at 4 already. You know, sometimes when you're a teammate, you don't even have to be the one that makes the shot. But when stuff starts going down for you as a team on the offensive end, everybody starts feeling good and loose. And all of a sudden now, a team gets on a hot streak.
Whistle away from the ball. Mays and Jordan Price got tied up underneath, and they say Price is guilty of the foul. And Kentucky at the free throw line this afternoon now for the 8th time. A little mix up there as Josh Wallace got the attention of Julius Mays. Mays thought Wallace was a little too aggressive on that first free throw box out. And now look at this Kentucky press, Kara, with Willie Cauley-Stein at the point. Polson called for the hand check. It's his first. Four ties, 6 lead changes this afternoon. And there's Auburn with an offensive rebound. Wow. Auburn couldn't convert. But Kentucky looks a step slow on defense, Kara.
Well, they're really attacking those bigs. They attacked Wilcher's feet there off the ball screen. Great job by Auburn's guards to get into the paint. Hold on to the basketball.
It's not going to take a James Naismith type to attack Wilcher, though.
No, it's not. But you know that. So you put him in ball screen action and you tell your guards to attack his feet.
He's gotten better, but not the swiftest in terms of speed as far as players go. And both teams having every shot attacked. Wow, an aggressive play there by Wallace. Tony Barbee wanted to push Wilcher. Point swing as Auburn can't get the lob, and Wilcher counters with a tray. Rice behind the back. And then Johnson palms it. Not a good sequence for the Tigers, but still they trail by just four. There you see that 30-2 record. Jack Givens with 41 in that NCAA final in St. Louis. Big event. We actually gave Kyle Macy the weekend off from his SEC network duties. The captain was here. And there's the coach. Here he and Louisville coach Denny Crum still do a daily radio show. And Joe's into his 80s, in great health. And they've had a big day today. And they're here seeing a good game tonight.
With that 2-2-1 pressure, and sometimes they'll extend, just try to get a steal, look to trap around the half-court area. Now they're back in their zone.
Auburn has come in here a 17-point underdog after losing big at home to the Cats, and they have asserted themselves well in the first part of this one. Poitras had it knocked away by Ahsan Dixon Tatum.
Ahsan Dixon Tatum has been very, very active. I mean, you look at that good 7-foot strong, agile body for the young man, and he's really impacted.
Shot clock. The Cats lost track of it. Mays tried to fake. And that goes down as Kentucky's fourth turnover, but to use a tennis analogy, that's an unforced error because they just lost track of the shot clock on the inbounds.
Got to be aware. No excuse. No excuse. Have to be aware.
Chubb comes back in, and Ahsan Dixon Tatum goes out after having a good run for the Tigers. Wow! Mays got laid out by a screen. That's got to be something, doesn't it? I mean, he either didn't get through it. It's got to be something on somebody. I mean,
as long as he's given a step, even if it's a blind screen, as long as he's given at least a step, it's legal. What the something is that his post player's got to let him know that the ball screen is there so that he doesn't run into it.
I mean, he ran into it and got laid out.
See how good that baseline is for Poitras? I mean, when he catches on the wing, rip through, attack, he's so strong. What player at the three position, which he's at now in the conference, is going to stop him from getting to the basket on a strong move like that?
He's 3 of 5 from the field as Kentucky equals its largest lead. The whole question about Poitras, though, Kara, has been his energy level. They've even gone to the step of putting a heart monitor on him during games.
The heart rate monitors have been used for John Calipari. We're going to take a look at the pick, and right now you see Wiltshire calling, but it's just not loud enough. See, as long as Johnson gives Mays at least one step with that blind screen, it's a legal pick. And Wiltshire calling it, but certainly not loud enough in the arena here, and Mays gets clocked on that
one.
Yeah,
but here's the thing about it. I don't know if we can take another look at it, but, he got a little chicken wing that helped him go right into the screen, and, you know. So that's running into the kicker unless you were blocked into the kicker.
Well, you're always trying to get a little elbow or a little hip if you can. A lot of times you can get that through.
Frankie Sullivan. That is a big-time good sign for Auburn as he hits his first three. The Tigers now 5 of 8 from outside that arc. And Kentucky answers. And Tony Barbee just incredibly unhappy with Rob Chubb. All right, now let's take a look at this pick play once again. Check the chicken wing out here. There he goes. Gets a little shove into him. And then he's not all the way in front of him. I would think a veteran offensive player
I don't think that's a foul.
Okay.
I really don't. I really don't. And I've been on the receiving end of those where you don't hear your post player call it, or they said they call it, or whatever happens, and you get clocked full speed. If you're that far back and you're Kyle Wiltshire, you have to make sure that Julius Mays knows that the pick is coming.
Now, check this out, and we've talked about the fact that, the rap on Kentucky right now is they're not real physical. So you saw Wallace, you know, with the little extra bump on Mays at the free throw line. It's not dirty, but it's part of a mindset thing, I think, Carol.
If you know a player does not like physical contact, you're going to do it. And you're going to do it after the whistle. And it's not necessarily hitting them after the whistle, but you're going to touch them. And you're going to annoy them. And you're going to do things like Wallace did to Mays to see how they respond, to see if it gets under their skin.
Dixon Tatum can't get it to go. Boy, Son Dixon Tatum has really given this Auburn team a nice lift here in the first half. And they have done what their coach said they had to do, and that's hit jump shots. That time, Johnson is going to get called for the shove underneath.
Auburn got lucky there because their pick and pop coverage right there was not very good, and they let Wilcher get an open look at the basket. If you're going to switch, switch. If not, Dixon Tatum's got to get on his horse, and he's got to get over to Kyle Wilcher and contest that three.
Johnson whistled for his second foul.
Olsen's a rock star here, Dave.
Oh, yeah. It's really like that. I mean, you know, they love him. He was a great high school player. He's kind of the Kentucky success story. But then you got middle school kids, you know, that.
Oh, Jared Bolton!
And his teammates give him a really hard time about it, too. Great kid.
Well, I can see why. He really changed this game for Kentucky in the first 5 minutes.
Tell you what else has changed as far as Kentucky goes this afternoon, Kara, is that by being able to knock down some jump shots, Auburn has been able to stay away from Nerlens Noel. We know what he's done in terms of blocking shots. He does not have a block as we approach the 4 minute mark of the first half. Dixon Tatum got another 50-50 ball. The transfer from Chattahoochee Tech via Anderson, Indiana. He almost took another one away from Noel, and this time he gets called for the foul.
You talked about Nerlens Noel not having a block, but he certainly is making his presence felt on the defensive end. He altered that shot. Kentucky up by 7.
Where do I get tires?
Calculating.
I cannot spend a lot of money.
S&S Tire.
What about the big box stores?
Negative. S&S Tire has the best prices.
Okay.
You know S&S Tire is your source for Bridgestone and Firestone tires, but did you know S&S Tire does service too? Stop by any S&S Tire location for a free winter inspection. And if you need new tires, S&S Tire has a full line of all-season Bridgestone and Firestone tires to fit your vehicle. S&S Tire, where the best costs less.
Dari Noka in studio. C Spire halftime report coming up in just a bit. Tempers flare in Columbia between Ole Miss and Missouri. Incredible ending between Wisconsin and Michigan. And Miami, North Carolina, the Canes making a strong pitch for a high ranking, guys. Thanks, Dari. We appreciate it. 31-24, Kentucky on top of Auburn here in Lexington. Let's take a look at some potential finalists for our Capital One Cup Impact Performance of the Week. And a good group to choose from, Carol.
Oh, there is. I mean, Marshall Henderson, what a season he's had thus far. Of course, Ole Miss going down to Mizzou in Columbia today. Arkansas, I mean, they throttled Florida. I mean, that I had been a huge Florida proponent in terms of one of the best teams in the country, if not the best team. And they certainly have some regrouping to do after that spanking in Bud Walton Arena.
Well, and that's a look at our Capital One Impact Performances of the Week. Log on to CapitalOneCup.com to vote for this week's Impact Performance. I'll tell you who's having an impact right now. John Calipari is having an impact on this Kentucky lineup. He talked yesterday about the fact that he's not watching tape with his team as Noel hits and he's doing life lessons and things. There has been a long period of time in this first half where Archie Goodwin and Ryan Harrow have been on that Kentucky bench. And Julius Mays, the graduate transfer student that they call Uncle Julius around here, and the walk-on Ryan Harrow have been running things in his Kentucky backcourt.
Well, Harrow just got the quick hook because he didn't win that 50-50 ball with Dixon Tatum there right before the break. And as soon as that happened, Calipari put Paulson back to the table.
Jared Paulson, the walk-on. I mean, again, and you don't want to overstate it, but when a coach the caliber of John Calipari, who's coming off a national championship season, says that a walk-on is his toughness guy and kind of tells you what kind of issues he's been plowing through this year. Nice lead, Sullivan to Chubb.
Nice hit by Chubb.
Frankie Sullivan has not been shooting the basketball well coming into this game, but he sure has given Rob Chubb a couple of great looks at the basket because of his aggressiveness on the drive and then passing off right at the last second.
Goodwin back in there now for Poitras as Kentucky has gone three guards. And I've really been impressed with Auburn's first half effort. Look at the double team on Noel. Shot clock at five. And Sullivan with a steal. Wow, Denson with a teardrop.
That was pretty. I mean, just the timing there got Noel off balance as Noel was trying to time up his jump for the block, and that was a great fast break execution there by Chris Denson.
Every time Noel gets it, he's getting the double team. Somebody else is going to have to make a shot for Kentucky. And Noel goes flying into the photographers. Auburn with numbers.
Well, this isn't just any old player that you're driving on. I mean, this is a nation's leading shot blocker. Nice little Euro step there by Denson. You see Ginobili do that in the NBA. You see Dwayne Wade. It just gives you that extra half second to put that little floater up, and wisely puts the floater up instead of going all the way to the rack for a layup.
I'm telling you, you really better float when you try to do that over top of Nerlens Noel.
Floater, runner, all those types of shots with a shot blocker of his caliber.
Goodwin, I think, thought that Noel was going to be there. I don't know whether he was trying to shoot a floater or whether he was trying to lob it up there, but Noel took a shot to the face.
It's been really physical out there today, hasn't it?
Got hit in the nose. And he took a shot to the head in practice on Thursday. He was out for a little while yesterday. And Calipari went into the spiel about Wally Pipp and Lou Gehrig.
And we talked and joked with them how they probably didn't even know who those two were.
Said Alex Smith and Colin Kaepernick might have been in better.
The modern day, Tom Brady, Drew Bledsoe.
Colley Stein comes in and provides some offense.
I love it when Kentucky's post players are aggressive, and when they know, when they feel that double team's not coming. And this is Colley Stein driving from the three-point line. I mean, how many seven-footers do you see that have that ability?
The former wide receiver in high school. Boy, no, we've got something going now, and they're going to go to the monitor. Archie Goodwin had his fists clenched. And credit Mark Whitehead, the official, for coming in and doing a really good job of defusing that before it got any worse. That could have been an all-out fight right there. Take a look. Boy, there you go. Boy, I'm telling you. It'll be interesting to see whether they say that Granger threw a punch.
Yeah, it looks like he did there.
And that would explain why Goodwin reacted the way he did. Jordan Granger, the freshman from Florissant, Missouri, He was 0 for 2 in 7 minutes as a starter. Got his first start last game versus Alabama. But they were boxing out underneath, and here's what the officials are looking at. Look at the bottom of the screen. There he's got a whole handful of jersey.
Yeah, that's a punch, Dave. That's a punch.
The officials have got a lot of discretion, Kara, and I think the guys in this league do a really good job. You saw Goodwin get him behind the neck. I think it would be really difficult to not say that that was a punch, though. There you saw Goodwin push off, and it's always the retaliation. The first thing that started at three phases, you had Granger, who had a handful, watch at the bottom.
Well, they're boxing out.
The
I mean, this is typical
right.
stuff to see. Even that stuff with Goodwin, that push off. Now, granted, it is at his neck, but
that may be a little atypical.
Well, from what we've seen, with Noel getting hit across the face,
all
with
right.
Pauly Stein getting hit earlier in the game, cracking his head, I mean, it's been physical out there.
I'm with you. So you had Granger get a handful of Goodwin shorts. Then you had Goodwin with the push, and it was above the shoulder, so they might take a look at that
right.
as a flagrant one or flagrant two. And then you had Granger with the retaliation. And as I was saying, I think these guys do a great job, but I think it's difficult to look at that retaliation as anything other than a punch. Here's the sequence again. Shorts, shoved by Goodwin.
Oh, it's a punch.
And then the retaliation by Granger. And you see those guys sitting there, and you know what? You think they might not be showing a lot of emotion. That's exactly what you're supposed to do in a situation like that, not get off the bench. So there you see the shove. Now, you could argue as to whether or not it was a very effective punch, but a punch is a punch is a punch.
That's right.
And there you see Mark Whitehead coming from the top. I mean, he did
Great job.
He did a really good job in that situation.
Yep.
One of the best officials in this league. There you see that crew. I know Tony Green does. I believe Mark Whitehead with Final Four experience as well. And they'll come over here and tell us. They're calling both coaches over right now. And once they come over, I'll let Kara slip off the headset, and they can fill us in on exactly what the call is. Again, that is exactly what the officials can go to the monitor for. To determine if a field goal is worth two or three, who the correct free throw shooter is, whether a fight occurred and who participated or left the bench but didn't participate, or to see if a flagrant two foul occurred that was missed by the officials that caused a player to become injured. And again, flagrant two, excessive contact during a live ball, excessive contact during a dead ball, an extreme or vulgar or abusive conduct, that is an automatic ejection. So John Calipari has gotten the explanation. He's fine. He's back at the Kentucky bench. And Tony Barbee has now gone back to his bench as well. And Mark Whitehead and company are now giving the word. And Tony Barbee giving the word to Granger as well. The word we have gotten from the scorer's table is that Granger has been ejected, and he's heading to the locker room. And the young man, you know, by all accounts, Granger's a great young man. That was just one of those things where there was a reaction, and I don't think the officials wanted to do that, but there are rules for a reason, and I think according to the way the rule book is written, the way that John Adams from the national level and Gerald Boudreau from the SEC level want their guys to officiate, I think they handled it properly. And he has been officially ejected for throwing a punch. And I believe that means that there will be a one-game suspension as well. And if that's the case, this has not been a good day from that standpoint for the SEC. Dari Noka, Barry Booker will update you at halftime. There was one of those incidents in the Missouri-Ole Miss game where Reginald Buckner was ejected for throwing a punch. And Mark Whitehead coming over here now. to give us the word on what's going on. So a call is fouled on Archie Goodwin on the rebound. And then, absolutely. And as soon as Kara gets the headsets back on, we'll tell you exactly what happened. And I think the guy's got it exactly right. Kara, so what was the official explanation from Mark Whitehead?
Well, the official explanation is the initial forearm by Goodwin, they're personal, calling as a personal foul.
Personal foul.
The retaliation of the punch from Granger, flagrant two, automatic ejection.
Right.
The retaliation by Goodwin after that, coming back, that is a technical foul. So Goodwin was assessed a personal foul and a technical foul on that play. And Granger was assessed a flagrant two, which results in automatic ejection.
But is the technical foul on Goodwin, does that also count as a personal foul? So in that sequence, did Archie Goodwin, in fact, pick up two personal fouls?
Boy, and after such a good half of basketball, it's exactly the thing that Tony Barbee did not want to see happen. Cats knocked down a three, and this now becomes a crucial possession for Auburn.
You have a stoppage of that long, there's generally a team that comes out and is able to carry that momentum into halftime. We'll see if that's Kentucky, if they gain some momentum from that.
Boy, Frankie Sullivan has been in an awful funk, but boy, he looked awfully good on that shot.
That's a big shot by Sullivan. Kentucky had started to stretch it out. Auburn absolutely needed a bucket there.
Auburn has stayed in this basketball game in the first half with 6 of 9 three-point shooting. Final possession of the half for the Cats. And good defense. Isn't it amazing how when somebody has been struggling offensively, all of a sudden they make a couple of shots and they play that much harder defensively?
You just feel better and you get into a groove, and that's what John Calipari was worried about. He does not want Frankie Sullivan feeling good.
Mays at the buzzer. And Frankie Sullivan in the first half, regaining his form, hit a couple of big threes, 6 rebounds, 3 assists, and he keeps the Tigers in it as the Wildcats of Kentucky lead it 37-31. A lot to come on our C Spire Halftime Report. Here's Dari Noka and Barry Booker. Gentlemen.
All right, thank you all very much. It is the C Spire Halftime Report, 37-31 Kentucky leading a bit of a pesky, will not go away Auburn team. That's good. That's a good watch for us here on the SEC Network. Dari Noka here, former Commodore Barry Booker there. And you can tell, like, Auburn is, you know, it was a physical game midweek in a win against Alabama. And they like that style of play, it seems like. What we just saw, the late fireworks, Jordan Granger, unfortunately for him, gets kicked out. But trying to deliver a message perhaps against Kentucky and Archie Goodwin, the recipient of what they deem is a punch. I suppose it's something similar to that, yes.
Yeah, these are not the type of things that you would say about Muhammad Ali, Mike Tyson. You think, was that a, could that have been a punch? I don't know. These are basketball players here. It's laughable.
Yeah, no.
Sort of.
Yes. It is. It's a weird feeling game. Twice now, yeah. It's felt like Auburn's about to get just kicked out of the way, yet they battle back.
Well, and you look at that Texas A&M game that Kentucky had also. You had the same feeling that day that Kentucky's going to put those guys away. Yeah. But A&M kind of hung in there and ended up winning that one.
6-point game. All right, tempers flaring in this one, too. Ole Miss, Missouri, two of the top five teams, really, in the SEC. And there's a putback by Lawrence Bowers. And then Phil Pressey. Boy, that's tough there. That's a tough play.
Missouri just dominating this game from the outset, reining in three-point shots.
Mention the physicality here. Reginald Buckner, Lawrence Bowers kind of fall to the floor there. Alex Oriaki actually brings Buckner down, kind of trips him. Now in the skirmish here, Buckner gets up. Bowers comes over, kind of gets pushed, goes into the fist of Buckner there. I'm not letting him off the hook by any stretch. He got kicked out.
Yeah.
Now we just wait and see if he's out for another game.
That looks more like a punch from that last angle they showed there.
More of a punch than Jordan Granger's punch. What a game. What moments from number one Ben Brust for Wisconsin. We'll show you. Incredible stuff.
Welcome to the SEC Game of the Week. It is presented by Regions Bank. Earlier this season, Kentucky with a 22-point win at Auburn. They held the Tigers without a three-pointer. This afternoon, Auburn staying in at 6 of 9 from outside the line. It's a six-point game at the half. Dave Baker and the Olympic gold medalist, Kara Lawson, here in Lexington. Kara, I think the MO has been for opponents to try to get physical with Kentucky, and the Cats have answered that with hustle, and they've answered it with some toughness from some unlikely places.
They have. It's been the hustle plays. First to the floor. A lot of coaches talk about that. Who's going to get on the floor first? And Kentucky has been first to the floor today, and it started in the first half with Jared Polson and Willie Cauley-Stein off of the bench, really infusing this team with some energy with hustle plays, those 50-50 balls that go a long way to winning the basketball game. Nerlens Noel getting into the act as well, and that hustle and that handling of the physical play is a huge reason why the Cats are up six.
That hustle is the reason that Polson is a former walk-on and now a scholarship player. As we take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Crystal, nothing like it.
But 6 for 9 for me from three is a stat that jumps out for Auburn. It's clearly those 18 points is what kept them in the basketball game. You know, Kentucky going to need to do a better job of guarding the three-point line here in the second half.
We will also update for you the situation that happened just before the end of the half, where the Tigers lost starter Jordan Granger on an ejection. There's been a lot of questions about free throws and things. Had a chance to visit with the officials, who I thought did a really nice job again of keeping a tense situation from getting out of hand. But in the meantime, Kentucky with the opening possession of the second half. Mays, Harrow, Wilcher getting the second half start. Poitras and Noel. And there's another 50-50 ball that the Cats get to. Boy, somebody is getting shoved in the back every time a ball goes up on this glass. These officials are really going to have to keep an eye on this thing, Kara.
Well, you think Coach Calipari's getting through to Ryan Harrow or not? Because who was the guy on the floor who didn't get on the floor in the first half for the loose ball to help his team and give that Wilcher an open look at the three? It was Harrow. Harrow got on the floor and got that loose ball. So the message is starting to sink in there for John Calipari and his point guard.
Kentucky on the foul gets a fresh 35. Auburn is led by as many as four. Kentucky's largest lead has been 9. And Auburn ended the first half despite that ejection by hitting 3 of their last 5 shots. Whistle away from the basketball, and the officials are going to get a handle on this one real quickly. Julius Mays picks up his second. You've got Chubb, Payne, Wallace, Sullivan, and Shaq Johnson getting the start in the second half now. And Chubb lost it out of bounds.
Great hustle there by Nerlens Noel just to create that turnover.
And now they call it illegal screen. Wilcher called for the fouls. And 3 possessions here in the second half. And 3 very quick fouls.
We always talk about setting the tone. Who do you think setting the tone right now to start the game?
Okay, lead
start,
guard.
Start the second half. It's the officials. They're setting the tone right now.
All right, lead guard. So how do you adjust on the court when this happens?
Well, you know that you're not going to get away with the little hip check that Wilcher tried to. You're not going to get away with pushing on Frankie Sullivan coming off the screen. You just have to be extra careful about all that stuff before and after the whistle.
Wallace called for the travel. 5th turnover of the afternoon against the Tigers. Noel Johnson checks into the Auburn lineup, as does Chris Denson. And that will send Shaq Johnson and Alan Payne to the Tiger bench.
You know, the other thing you have to do is you have to tell your teammates the same thing, that it's a little bit tighter now, but just play. You don't want that tightness of the whistle to become tentative play on either end of the floor.
Wilcher with the left hand goes to work on the post up. And Auburn with 3 second half possessions, 2 turnovers, and this time, nice substitution
by Tony Barbee. Noel Johnson comes back in and gives him another triple.
It's that same action we talked about in the first half. Noel Johnson forces you to stretch out because he's a guard playing the four position, a wing playing the four position, and Wiltshire has not been able to close back out and take away his clean looks at the basket.
Problem is that Johnson just picked up his third foul. Johnson himself, 4 of 6 from outside the arc. First time that these two teams met, Auburn was 0 for 15 in three-point shots. And today, the Tigers are 7 out of 10, and that's the number that Tony Barbee told us before the game he felt like they had to have a shot.
In the game. I mean, they've got 7 with 17 minutes left. I mean, this is not even close if Auburn is not as proficient from beyond the arc as they have been this afternoon.
Nice feed inside. Chubb with a rarity. He gets position on Nerlens Noel.
Great job there by Rob Chubb. He did his work early, utilized his strength advantage over Nerlens Noel, and backed him down so deep it didn't matter about the length and the reach of the nation's leading shot blocker.
I still think Noel is without a block today.
This is what you do. A shot blocker, you bury him. You attack, you go straight up, you go through his body, and you force him to make a play and counter your physical move towards the basket. Great play there. Great call by Tony Barbee. Great execution there by the center, Rob Chubb.
Noel with just one field goal. Poitras draws the contact. He's got 8 rebounds. He's only committed 1 foul, but I don't think he has a block. And that is not because of his lack of effort. I think that's excellent execution by Auburn of the scout.
It's great execution by Auburn, but I will say this. I felt there were 4 or 5 times in the first half, Dave, where Noel altered a shot or altered the decision of the guard driving in, where they knew he was there and they said, you know what, I'm not going to go after him. I'm going to pull it back out or throw the pass. Now, we did see Denson attack in a beautiful transition play in the first half where he actually went at Noel and was able to score the bucket.
Kentucky, who has not been the greatest free throw shooting team this year. As a matter of fact, the Cats 12th in the SEC at 64.5%. This afternoon, 11 of 16 from the line. Noel knocked that one away from Chubb. And Wallace couldn't get the jumper to go. Boy, I'm telling you now. Again, I think these officials are doing a pretty good job. And you know what? Everybody's playing hard. But that was a pretty good forearm in the back there by Chubb.
He's getting it from all angles there. Yeah, it's a forearm in the back. He had guys on his forearms as he's trying to pull up. Wallace there, grabbing and holding him down. It's a triple team there. And again, contact.
And again, that's the 4th foul as Chubb goes to the bench. Nerlens Noel is a young man who's done a really good job of keeping his cool. And they're going to get Goodwin for the charge. That's Goodwin's 3rd. And 23,000 here in Rupp reacting to a replay on the video board. Boy, what a pretty drive. Chris Denson has really got a burst.
He's athletic. I mean, he has great ability to get from point A to point B really, really quickly. That's the 2nd time that he's challenged Noel and won that challenge.
And Auburn just keeps hanging around. There's Polson. Noel got an offensive rebound. Boy, there's more. After every play, there's activity. I'm telling you, these officials will have earned their money today because they are going to have to ride herd on this thing. We've already had one ejection. More on that when we come back to Ruck.
Coach Cal makes the call.
Coach Cal, we're thinking we should plan more aggressively for retirement. Can you make the call?
Hey, I'm a basketball guy, not a money guy. You want my advice? Let the pros at Central Bank make the call.
Central Bank, can you help us?
Yes, we can. How aggressively you plan for your retirement depends on how the rest of your finances are doing. Let us help. Come to Central Bank for a relationship review.
Hey, good call, Central. Good call.
Kentucky on top of Auburn as we start the second half of the SEC schedule. Dave Baker, Kara Lawson here, and this was an incident in the first half that could have been much worse than it was, Kara.
Oh, absolutely. You see Archie Goodwin and Jordan Granger getting into it there at the bottom of your screen, and Granger ejected, automatic ejection, as he was assessed with a flagrant 2 technical foul. Goodwin assessed with 2 fouls on a play. First, a personal foul for that forearm shiver he gives to incite Granger to give him that punch. And then for coming back, he gets a technical foul for after getting punched, he came back and went into Granger's face.
And the technical foul counts as a personal foul against Goodwin and a team personal foul. And one more thing to clear up there. Mark Whitehead, the lead official, was talking to us just before the start of the half. A lot of people have asked about the free throws. There were no free throws there because the contact technical and then the response technical offset each other.
The flagrant 2 technical by Granger and the contact technical by Goodwin, kind of like in football, offsetting penalties. They offset correct one another. No free throw shot. And the free throw that was shot by Auburn was from the first foul, the point of interruption,
which was the personal foul.
And that's why Auburn shot the free throw.
Absolutely. So the Auburn foul trouble, Dixon Tatum with 4, Chubb with 4, Johnson with 3. And it's really interesting. We were all talking during a break here about this game is more than a little chippy right now. And there is a deep personal and respected relationship between John Calipari and Tony Barbee. It's not like these are two guys that don't like each other. There's two guys that love each other.
You know, there's just been some extracurricular from the beginning, before the whistle, after the whistle, off the ball, and Auburn has just made it clear that they're not going to let Kentucky get anything easy on the offensive end.
Paulson with another hustle play. How he earned his scholarship. And there you see Tony Barbee, who not only spent time with John Calipari as an assistant coach, but look at that. That's kind of an early Nerlens Noel haircut right there. Tony played at UMass.
Did he have UMass shaved in the back of that?
I don't think he did. Had a great run up there at UMass, though. Olsen had a hand on it, but Denson took it away. And look at the little guy, Harrow. Noel Johnson talking to Wilcher, who passed on the three-pointer. And the Wildcats throw it away. And Noel will take a seat. And Willie Cauley-Stein, 7-footer from Olathe, Kansas, checks in after the Cats turn it over for the 7th time. And Mays team up for the strip, and Sullivan is going to get called for an intentional foul. Here you see Steven Anderson talking to the scorer's table and signaling the intentional foul. It's a flagrant one.
You saw Tony Barbee really getting after Frankie Sullivan, and I don't think he's getting after him because of the foul. I think he's getting after him because Noel Johnson has hit 4 3-pointers. They set up a pick-and-pop situation, and Frankie Sullivan tries to get his own and split the pick, and as a result, turns it over. I think that's why Barbie's fired up.
Wiltshire knocks them both down. Again, a flagrant one. Not a legitimate play on the ball, a holder, a push from behind, or an illegal elbow above the shoulders. Now, from that angle, it looks like Frankie Sullivan is making a play on the ball, but when you look at it from behind and look how he wraps Wiltshire up and then slings him to the ground.
That's what did it, the wrap up and slinging him to the ground.
Cats turn it over. Bad shot by Johnson that time. Fans coming up next Saturday on the SEC Network at 1:30. Florida visits Auburn, and at 4, South Carolina takes on Alabama. Check your local listings for the game and station in your area. Jared Polson again getting a big hand from this crowd. He has absolutely been a glue guy for this Kentucky team today.
There's 13 minutes left in the ball game, but Auburn has to be very careful right here, and that's exactly why Tony Barbee's going to take the timeout.
Oh, wow. And I think even the frustration showing on the part of the coach. Sullivan over-aggressive. The Cats in overdrive. Auburn in trouble. Boy, this has been a testy afternoon for everybody in Rupp Arena as Kentucky's equaled its largest lead. Look at the end of this when Tony Barbee calls timeout.
I thought that was clean.
Thought he got all ball?
Yeah, it's all ball. I didn't think he got any forearm.
He was obviously trying to get a message to his point guard, Josh Wallace. I'm telling you, people can agree or disagree. I love people talking about things. I'm telling you, if you're a coach or a player on either one of these teams or you're an official, this is exactly the kind of game, Garrett, where you just want to get out of here. Get to the final whistle and get out of here, because it has been a difficult afternoon for all involved.
It has been, and I'm not so sure all of Tony Barbee's ire in that instance was directed toward Josh Wallace. I think he's frustrated about the inability of his team to execute what he wants on the offensive end. And that's enabled Kentucky here to stretch this thing out to 9 points.
And you know, people might say, well, did these officials get a hold of this game or not? I mean, I thought when they came out to start the second half, every time you breathed on somebody, there was a whistle.
I don't think there's any question that they have control of the game. It's just that it continues to be physical. And you know, neither team is going to bend, and that's the type of urgency that you get.
Oh, my goodness. And Sullivan, he just cleared out Willie Cauley-Stein.
I think it was Julius.
Check
Mays
it out.
Here.
It was Julius. There you go.
Yeah, just bumping the cutter. And Mays smartly, I don't know if that was enough of a bump to send Mays flying, but Mays smartly goes down there, and he gets the call. Now, Sullivan and Mays have been
all day,
kind of going at each other
all day.
Yep.
And Frankie Sullivan has played well. He's been a great representative for this team. But I'm telling you, he's got to get it under control. I mean, that's a shot you can either take or not take. And the one thing that Kentucky does to answer is they continue hitting from the free throw line. Auburn, 3 of 5 from the stripe, and Kentucky, 16 of 22.
Remember, Kentucky got into that bonus early there in the first half, 13 minutes left in the game. or left in the first half, I should say, they were in the bonus shooting free throws.
Goodwin called for the foul. That's his fourth. Auburn has been whistled for 20 fouls, Kentucky for 13. Nice rebound, Willie Cauley-Stein. Wiltshire early in the season really liked the transition triple, but he has chosen not to take it on several occasions this afternoon. Nice move there, couldn't get it to go. Kentucky on, I'm going to say, at least a half dozen occasions has gotten it up to nine. But they've not been able to extend the lead larger than that. And once again, Auburn answers with a big bucket.
Sullivan's done that a few times this afternoon. It looks like Kentucky's about to get away like it did in the end of that first half. And he's able to come up with huge buckets for them just to keep life for them on the offensive end.
Wiltshire battling in the low post against Shaq Johnson. Here's Mays.
Great activity there by Willie Cauley-Stein. And with how much Auburn is getting switched, a lot of times there's a guard ending up or Noel Johnson is ending up on Cauley-Stein. That's a mismatch, enabled him to get in there and get the dunk.
Sullivan couldn't get it to go. This time, Wiltshire takes it.
There's your transition three, Dave Baker. Kentucky team that's won six of their last seven, and a big part of that has been Willie Cauley-Stein. This is the third game back. He's making his presence felt on the offensive end, the energy, and how about the sweet shooting stroke of Kyle Wiltshire? What a luxury it is to have a four-man that can trail the play and knock it down with such ease.
And what about the Cats? At this time of year, most coaches talk about shortening up their bench and shortening their rotations. It looks like John Calipari is expanding that bench. You've got Polson, who's back in there now, who's had a big day. Willie Cauley-Stein, and as you mentioned, Wiltshire et al. Kentucky started 0 of 3 from beyond the arc. They're 6 of 17 since. And the contact continues to be there. But the Cats have opened it up to a 12-point lead.
It's a whole new Februenny at Subway. Now you can get any footlong for a song. That's right. Many of our scrumptious footlongs are $5 footlongs. And we've got amazing $6 footlong specials, too. Enjoy favorites like the turkey breast as $5 footlongs. And hearty subs like the steak and cheese as $6 footlong specials. Subway. Eat fresh.
Great job by Auburn out of that timeout. Set piece. Gets Denson a nice floater. Now Auburn goes back to this zone.
Alex Poitras got off to a good start early and has been the case frequently this year. All of a sudden, he just kind of disappeared. And Auburn had a chance in transition and threw it away.
Tucking in for Kentucky is Ryan Harrell.
Arrow checks back in, and another big hand for Jared Paulson, a former walk-on who earned himself a scholarship and just earns more love from this crowd every time he comes in.
Of this, and this is what makes you think that there's just more in store for this Cats team in the future. Great look there by Alex Poitras, and Cauley Stein with the finish. It starts with the awareness of Noel, understanding the double team, the great timing of the cut by Poitras. What a pass.
Johnson. Son Dixon Tatum. Head to the Auburn bench. Chubb checks back in. He's got four fouls along with Dixon Tatum. Johnson has four. Frankie Sullivan with three. Inside. Cauley Stein called for his third. Auburn in the bonus from this point forward, and Shaq Johnson at the line.
Well, Sheen, the issue with Auburn offensively, Tony Barbie talked about before the game, if you don't have Noel Johnson in the game, who's been proficient from beyond the arc, you don't have Frankie Sullivan in the game, who's one of your better shooters, then it's really tough to spread the floor and to make shots against this team. And you decide to drive against a front line with 2 7-footers back there, good luck making a play doing that.
Just an incredibly physical game this afternoon. Both teams trying to start the second half of this SEC season with a win, and Harrell wide open on his way to the rim. And Tatum had it knocked away. Eight turnovers by the Tigers. And Hassan Dixon Tatum is going to get called, I believe, for his fifth. Kentucky on top of Auburn, 59-46, 7:38 to play here in Lexington. Coming up on Tuesday, this one looks like it's becoming size huge.
Kentucky and Florida, and who would have thought that at this stage of the game that Kentucky would be with an opportunity to be tied for first place in the SEC. I mean, this team has come a long way, and John Calipari would be the first to tell you, we still have a long way to go, but for them to be 7-2, on the verge of potentially 8-2 is a testament to this group and their ability to continue to improve and mature.
There's Hassan Dixon Tatum, who I thought gave this Auburn team a really good lift today, but he fouls out. Only had 2 points, but had a couple of rebounds. I thought brought a lot of energy, a lot of fight to this Auburn team.
About Nerlens Noel, 7-for-9 from the free throw line this afternoon.
But the stat that everybody will look at, he is still blockless.
That's going to hurt his average, huh?
Almost got one there, but boy, another floater over the outstretched arm. At five, good defense by the Tigers. And Harrell is fouled by Chubb, and that'll be his fifth.
Well, Ryan Harrell, this is the second possession in a row. He's just been extremely aggressive, going off that ball screen and looking to get into the lane. Chubb not very happy with that one.
Chubb, the second Tiger to foul out. And that puts Kentucky in the double bonus.
We'll see how this plays for Auburn, because this puts them in a little bit of a dilemma in terms of size. They're going to have to go small. Certainly could be an advantage for them on the offensive end, but clearly a disadvantage for them potentially on the defensive end and on the glass. All five guys are going to have to get on the defensive boards.
Auburn 5 of 7 from the free throw line today, and Kentucky now 20 of 26. Harrow called for the foul in the backcourt.
The foul is on Harrow. That's his first of the team's eighth.
First foul against Harrow, eighth against the Wildcats. And that'll put Josh Wallace at the free throw line.
Wallace at the line for one of the bonus.
You know, we talked about Auburn being at a size disadvantage here, at least across the front line. What this group will enable them to do is, because they're interchangeable, they can switch everything if they needed to, at least two through five, but also the pressure. They can bring full court pressure, fly around a little bit, and try and create some turnovers with Kentucky only having three ball handlers on the floor.
Nice job by Wallace at tracking down that missed free throw. And let's see what Auburn can do with the extra possession. Nice pass. Jack Johnson will go to the free throw line. Second against Harrow. Wallace goes to the Auburn bench. Poitras free. And Tony Green waves off the basket.
Well, that's the kind of scattered defensive possession that Auburn needed to have, playing small, just around the ball, help side right where they need to be, anticipating the Poitras drive, able to get the turnover.
Poitras called for his fourth. Nice drive. I believe Harrow got that one. It didn't get to Noel. Oh,
And it doesn't catch the rim. Shot clock violation against the Tigers.
Well, that's a really good possession there by Kentucky. Everyone active, working out of hand and playing defense for 35 seconds right there, completing the play.
And a whistle away from the ball. And Wallace is going to get called for the foul. That's his third.
Well, that's what you talked about, what I talked about earlier there, Dave. With that smaller lineup, you can switch everything, but you have to be careful if it's the 1-5 screen, because now Wallace is switching on to either Noel or Cauley Stein, and that puts Auburn at a real big disadvantage, and you see the only option he had there was to foul.
Poitras got that missed free throw.
That's right. Run offense here. Run offense. You've got a 13-point lead. You don't want to let the air out of the ball, so to speak, but you have time to let something develop here.
This has been a hard-fought game. And I think you can see it in the body lean of these guys on both teams. Payne back in there, comes out of there with it for Auburn. Nice drive. All the energy that's been expended, baskets coming fewer and more far in between.
That's not a good sign if you're Auburn. I mean, you talk about how much effort and energy both teams have put into this, but
are you kidding me?
He almost got that first one.
I mean, he was a wide receiver in high school, so he can go up and get it, but boy, did he have to go up the ladder to catch this pass.
He almost got that first one and brought the thunder with it, but no one there to challenge him at the top and no one there to challenge him at the bottom either, and that's a problem if you're Auburn. I can understand with the short front line not challenging Cauley Stein at the top, but somebody better be there on the bottom to make their presence felt.
Payne called for the foul. And Kentucky extends its largest lead to 16. Nice drive. Johnson got it to go.
Now, this is a good opportunity, particularly on the offensive end, for Kentucky to play with their 2 7-footers, to play with their two big offense, to work in tandem with one another. This is a rotation I'm sure we'll see more and more of as the year goes on. Great high-low there from Noel to Cauley Stein.
Nice feed from Wallace. And it was knocked out of bounds. Cats looking to put the finishing touches against Auburn. Today's SEC basketball game is brought to you by Wendy's. New right price, right size menu with big taste you can't find anywhere else. USAA, proudly serving the financial needs of the military, veterans, and their families. And by the new Buick Enclave. It's smart, made beautiful. There you see the Speaker of the House, John Boehner, who represents the Southwest District of Ohio. It's only about a, that's his wife there as well. It's only about an hour, 15-minute drive. He's been here before. And Joe B. Hall, who was honored this weekend with his 1978 national champions and his banner, one of the many hanging in the rafters here at Rupp Arena. As the Tigers try to finish this one out strongly. They really came in here and played hard this afternoon against a Kentucky team That was one of the hottest in the SEC, but a lot of folks wondered whether or not they would be looking ahead to that Tuesday night showdown against Florida.
How about Chris Denson this afternoon? I mean, he has really, really played well attacking. And the one Auburn player outside of the three-point shots that's been able to solve the athleticism of Noel while driving.
Arrow couldn't get the reverse to go. And Harrow called for the foul. As you look at the SEC standings, and Florida underway right now against Mississippi State, a Mississippi State team that's without Jalen Steele. And that looks like it could be the Super Tuesday matchup of the year in the SEC.
Yeah, we're heading for it, aren't we? Tuesday night. Kentucky out Florida. And take a look at this young Kentucky team, and you know, there's been a lot of talk about the struggles and the growing pains this team has had. But remember back in 2010 and 2011, the team that ultimately went to the Final Four, lost by a point to the eventual champion UConn. Dave, they were 2-6 on the road in SEC play that year. 8-0 at home, but 2-6 on the road. And this is a Cats team that's 4-1 on the road already. So, yes, they have some youth. Yes, it's taken them some time, but they have proven to be tough on the road in SEC slate. Can't wait to see that test against Florida.
Wow, what a delivery from Denson to Shaq Johnson. And that play right there was exactly what John Calipari was talking about. Archie Goodwin missed on the defensive, on the offensive end, hung his head, and didn't get back on defense. And that's the kind of thing that Calipari has been working so hard with this Kentucky team on. And
not having mistakes, right? Yeah. I mean, he talked about the film that he showed his guys. He showed them the clip of Victor Oladipo in Indiana in their upset loss against Illinois. Before that layup, Oladipo lost the ball, turned it over, but he goes back on the defensive end and he makes a defensive play by getting a block. So he's trying to instill in his players that once you make a mistake, it's not about you at that juncture. It's about what you can do to get back in the play and help your team.
Rice. And that was a shove in the back. Noel just absolutely shoved Shaq Johnson in the lower back. And I want to make sure we hit on a point here before we go away, Kara. You know, Frankie Sullivan was out there and things were getting chippy and everything. And we've seen Frankie Sullivan for a number of years in this league. I don't think Frankie Sullivan's a dirty player. But I think, in my comment at the time, I think that his coach saw how frustrated he was getting. And we were just checking the stats here. And Frankie has not been on the court since the 10-19 mark. And I think that is by design, and I think that's a good move on the part of Tony Barbee.
Well, absolutely, it's by design. I mean, you don't sit your leading scorer, one of your best three-point shooters, when you're trying to make a comeback, and three-pointers are of the essence, if it's not by design.
Good decision by Polson to pull it out.
We talked about how John Calipari and Tony Barbee are both very similar. And you know, Tony Barbee coached under John Calipari for many years.
Played for him.
And played for him. You are going to play a certain way for both of these gentlemen. And if you decide at any point in the game that you are not going to play that way, then you will no longer be in the game. And that's just how it works. That's how it works at the University of Kentucky, and that's how it works at Auburn. And so at 10-19, Frankie Sullivan decided he wasn't going to play a certain way. And as a result, he doesn't get the call back into the game.
Great point. One other number to take a look at as Harrow hits the free throw. As we go down the stretch, Nerlens Noel has had some incredible games defensively this year. But as we approach the 1 minute mark, he is still without. Oh, there he got it, right on cue. Thank you very much. That was his first block of the day, and he was 1 minute away from having his first game without a block shot.
Couldn't let that happen.
Three previous times this year, Noel had one block. The last time was in one of those home court losses to Baylor. But that was his first of the day. And even though he's delighted at getting that block shot, he's even happier with the way he shot free throws. He's 7 of 11 from the line today. And he has now, once the stat screen updates, I believe, yes, he has gotten another double-double. 10 points, 11 rebounds. And credit this Auburn team as Wallace hits. They continue to fight. And they got that win over Alabama the other night, but it's been a rough stretch for Auburn. And they return home Wednesday night to take on Arkansas, the team they lost to in double overtime in Fayetteville.
This was a hard-fought win for Kentucky, a very, very good conference win for them, and it sets up that showdown with first-place Florida Tuesday night.
John Calipari got to be awfully happy with that kind of balance. Price picks up his third foul.
Also not bad, the fact that your two leading scorers in the game, both Wiltshire and Cauley-Stein, are two players that you bring off the bench. So great amount of firepower, nice balance to this team.
And free throws definitely a part of the story today. Auburn 10 of 15. And Kentucky now 26 of 38. Called for that foul. So with this one 13 and a half seconds away, here are your updated standings. And you see just how tight it is at the top. Ole Miss with that loss at Missouri today. One Sunday game, the only Sunday game in the league on the men's side this year is tomorrow with Tennessee at South Carolina. And Ole Miss still in that battle at the top as well at Texas A&M on Wednesday night. John Calipari said he'd feel sick after this game because even if he won, it would not be a good day for a young man he respects a lot, Tony Barbee. And you see that genuine exchange right there. But it's Calipari's Cats who get the victory. And who now set up a huge showdown on Tuesday night, Kara.
Absolutely. A big-time win. We talked about the balance, five players in double figures, the toughness that Kentucky showed today in fighting through the physical play.
Once again, our final. It's Kentucky 72, Auburn 62 for Kara Lawson and our entire SEC Network crew. I'm Dave Baker. The preceding and exclusive presentation of ESPN Regional Television, the worldwide leader in collegiate sports.